behind me, the cross before me, the world behind me, the cross before me, no turning back, no turning back.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, one with God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
You are a treasured people of the Lord.
Be people holy to the Lord our God.
Keep the words of the Lord in your heart, teach them to your children.
Have taught them when you are at home, and when you are awake, when you lie down, and when you rise.
For one does not live by bread alone,
but by every word that comes from the mouth of the Lord.
Let us pray. Lord God,
you showed your glory and led many to faith by the works of your Son.
As he brought gladness and healing to his people, grant us these same gifts, and lead us also to perfect faith in him. Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
You may be seated. You know what, before we go into the scriptures, why don't we sing our opening hymn, hymn number 84. Now the word of the Lord came to me, saying, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. And before you were born, I consecrated you. I appointed you a prophet to the nations. Then I said, ah, Lord God, behold, I do not know how to speak, for I am only a youth. But the Lord said to me, do not say, I am only a youth. For to all to whom I send you, you shall go. And whatever I command you, you shall speak. Do not be afraid of them, for I am with you to deliver you, declares the Lord. Then the Lord put out his hand and touched my mouth. And the Lord said to me, Behold, I have put my words in your mouth. See, I have sent you this day over nations and over kingdoms to pluck up and to break down, to destroy and to overthrow, to build and plant. Here ends the reading of the first lesson.
Psalm today is 114, it's on page 271. Hallelujah, when Israel came out of Egypt.
The house of Jacob from a people of strange speech.
Judah became God's sanctuary.
And Israel his dominion.
The sea beheld it and fled.
Jordan turned and went back.
The mountains skipped like rams.
And the little hills like young sheep.
What ailed you, O sea, that you fled?
O Jordan, that you turned back.
You mountains that you skipped like rams.
You little hills like young sheep.
Tremble, O earth, at the presence of the Lord.
At the presence of the God of Jacob.
Who turned the hard rock into a pool of water.
And flint stone into a flowing spring. Here ends the reading of the psalm. The second lesson is from St. Paul's first letter to Corinthians, the 9th chapter, beginning with the 24th verse. St. Paul writes, by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, Do you not know that in a race all the runners run, but only one receives the prize? So run that you may obtain it. Every athlete exercises self-control in all things. They do it to receive a perishable wreath, but we an imperishable. So I do not run aimlessly. I do not box as a bee in the air. But I discipline my body and keep it under control, lest after preaching to others, I myself should be disqualified. Here is the reading of the second lesson. And I invite you to please rise for the reading of the gospel. Jesus said, For the kingdom of heaven is like a master of a house who went out early in the morning to hire laborers for his vineyard. After agreeing with the laborers for a denarius a day, he sent them into his vineyard. And going out about the third hour, he saw others standing idle in the marketplace. And to them he said, You go into the vineyard too, and whatever is right I will give you. So they went. Going on again, at about the sixth hour and the ninth hour, he did the same. And about the 11th hour, he went out and found others standing. And he said to them, Why do you stand here idle all day? They said to him, Because no one has hired us. He said to them, You go into the vineyard too. And when evening came, the owner of the vineyard said to the foreman, Call the laborers and pay them their wages, beginning with the last up to the first. And when those hired about the 11th hour came, each one of them received a denarius. Now when those hired first came, they thought they would receive more, but each of them also received a denarius. And on receiving it, they grumbled at the master of the house, saying, these last worked only 1 hour, and you have made them equal to us, who have borne the burden of the day and the scorching heat. But he replied to one of them, friend, I am doing you no wrong. Did you not agree with me for a denarius? Take what belongs to you and go. I choose to give to this last worker as I give to you. Am I not allowed to do what I choose with what belongs to me? Or do you begrudge my generosity? So the last will be first, and the first last. The Gospel of our Lord. You may be seated. Let us pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you. We thank you that you've gathered us to be in the presence of your Son, for he has promised that where two or three are gathered in his name, there he is in the midst of them. So we welcome you, Lord Jesus, and we give you the glory and the praise and the honor and the worship that belongs to you. Lord, as we come before you this morning, we just ask that you open up our eyes to see and our ears to hear and our hearts to receive. And whatever is of sin, or of temptation, or of the flesh, or of the devil, we pray, Lord, that it would fall to the ground and die and be of no effect, so that we're completely open to receive from you what you have for us today. Let your word be planted deeply in our hearts and bear fruit for eternal life. And now, Lord, may the word of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be truly acceptable in your sight, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Amen. Thank you. Grace to you, peace from God our Father, and from the Lord Jesus Christ. In the prophet Jeremiah, we read these words in verse 5. He says, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. And before you were born, I consecrated you. These words have a great deal of significance for us as Christians, but also from the society in which we live and from the world in which we live. And so I'd like us to explore these words, this word of God, more closely. And in particular, I want us to consider this. Who determines the value of your life? Who determines the sacredness of your life? How does that get resolved? We find here in these words something that we need as people of God, but our society needs to hear as well. Again, God says, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. And before you were born, I consecrated you. What that means is that your value and my value, your sacredness and my sacredness are not determined from the time of our conception, not determined from the time of our birth, not determined from the moment that your parents decide whether they love you or not, not determined by society, not determined by how valuable you are, what you have to give to society. Your value, your sacredness, your purpose were determined by God even before you were conceived. What that means is this. You and I and every human being that has ever existed, they are not and we are not accidents. We are not here because of the will of man. We're not here because society says we should be. We exist because God himself determined even before we were formed in the womb that we should be here for his purposes. By the way, that's good news. It's good news because it means that each and every human being has within him or her intrinsic value. We have value no matter what the world says about us. We have value whether or not your parents want you. We have value whether society says you should exist or not. We have value because God himself has said, I knew you, I set you apart, I consecrated you, I have a purpose for your life. And no one can take that away. No one has the right to take that away. And it's very important for us to see. Now, there are some people who will say, well, okay, Pastor, if everybody has a purpose in life, then why don't we see people acting according to God's purpose more often? Well, it's a very simple answer. It's called sin. We have sin in our lives. We have a sinful nature. And once we're conceived, we have that sin nature in us, and we're naturally oriented away from what God wants. But God sent his Son, Jesus, into the world to take care of the sin issue in our lives. And when we come to him in faith, in repentance, confessing our sins, God the Father will forgive our sins, cleanse us by the blood of Jesus, fill us with the Holy Spirit, and establish us in the purpose that he created for us well before we were ever a twinkle in our parents' eyes. Well before you were ever considered, God had established a plan for you and good works for you to perform. The problem with the human race isn't that God hasn't given us a purpose. The problem with the human race is that sin has kept us from going forward into those purposes. But God, through Jesus, sent his Son to establish us again into the purposes that the Father has for us. Every human being, then, originally has a godly purpose and function to fulfill. And that's why, as Christians, it's very important for us to connect people up with Jesus. Because every human being, no matter how small, no matter how large, no matter how old, has this divine appointment and purpose on their life. But they will never know about it unless we preach the word, share Jesus, and they meet the Lord, and then are filled with his Spirit, so that they can walk by his grace and the purposes that he had for them from the very beginning. But now, I want to address something else that's very, very important. And by the way, when this word was given to me, I was not thinking about the significance of this day. I really wasn't. I did not know that today is Sanctity of Life Sunday. And I did not know that this is the day when Roe versus Wade was enacted. But today, when we hear this word, what is God saying to our country and to the Christians of this country? He is saying something very important. And this isn't about politics, folks. It's about what God's word says. Every human being, has a God-given purpose and is made in the image of the Almighty. And according to God, you and I do not have the right to kill off those who are made in the image of God. We do not have the right to cut off the life of those who are in the womb. We do not have the right to say to the old and the infirm and those who have emotional and mental problems, well, you're not offering anything to society, so I guess you have to die. And please understand that Planned Parenthood was established by a woman and by those who supported her who had every intention of killing off black people and poor whites and Hispanics because they believed they were inferior people who had nothing to offer society and they were not worthy of the breath of life. That's a sin. It's a sin. Because you don't get to decide whether someone is worthy of the breath of life. God does. And when God says, before I knew you, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you, that means that God, as soon as someone's conceived, guess what? God had already planned, before the earth was even formed, that person is here for a purpose. And who are we to try to stop God's purpose? Somebody might say, well, you know, that person may not have been a productive member of society. Big deal. God had a purpose. Even if that child only lives 2 minutes, God had a purpose for that child. You have a purpose and a plan that you don't get to decide. God's already decided it. And please understand that God can use your life, especially when you're not in control anymore. Now, I'll give you one example. It actually has to do with an older woman. It was like my first couple of years of ministry, and I was going down to Devil's Lake, and I was at the nursing home. It was called the Lutheran Home at that time. And there was a lady there in a coma, and she had never spoken to her family, certainly not to me, in the couple of years that I had seen her. They considered her in a vegetative state. So her husband and her son, adult son, asked him to come and give communion to the group. So I went down. And she can't take communion, obviously. But we're getting things ready, and we get to the Lord's Prayer. And we conclude, with thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. And the husband said amen. And the son said amen. And to the amazement of everybody in the room, she said amen. That wasn't by her strength. That was God saying something. Remember what Jesus said to those who believe, I will not leave you orphaned. She had lost everything, but not him. Not him. It was a witness to those in the room. And by the way, if that was the only reason that she was born, she fulfilled her destiny by imparting faith into her family. And even faith to me. We don't have a right to determine for others whether their purpose meets our agenda and therefore they're allowed to live. We don't have that right. That life in the womb, all the way to the natural ending of life, is God's life, filled with His purpose. Designed to share the love of God and the truth of His Word with others. As the church, we must never agree with society that says that it is a person's right. In fact, their duty to kill those who are in the womb. And we must never agree with a state that says, well, if you don't feel like your life has any purpose, you're free to kill yourself. Or you're free to have a doctor do it for you. As the church, our job is to declare the Word of God and invite people to meet Jesus so that they can walk in the purpose that God has for them. So on this Sanctity of Life Sunday, as we consider all the marches that were going on yesterday, Let's pray that the Lord will put an end to abortion and put an end to euthanasia and put an end to the lie of the enemy that says to people that your worth and your value is determined by what you say or I say or the world says or what you can accomplish. If you're here, you have a divine mandate and purpose to exist. Our job as a church is to help people meet Jesus so they can fulfill that destiny. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. All right, we'll sing our next hymn. 369, the church is one foundation.
Pilate was crucified, died, and was buried. he descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
We'll now receive the offering. Return to you a portion of what you've given us for the work of your kingdom. We pray, Lord, that you would just multiply this seed for the salvation of many souls. Lord, we also pray that you would bless those who have sown this seed. They may always have what they need to meet the needs of their families and also to share with others the good news of Jesus Christ. We thank you, Lord, and we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let us pray for the people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Gracious Heavenly Father, it is your will that all people should come to you through your Son. Stir up your Holy Spirit within your church, within this congregation, that we may in thought, word, and deed reveal the good news of Jesus Christ and bring many to saving faith. Lord, pour out your Holy Spirit upon us mightily. Let every gift of the Spirit, fruit of the Spirit, rise up among us and bear fruit, so that people may taste and see that the Lord is good. Bring your Holy Spirit revival to our area, 100 miles in every direction, north, south, east, and west, that people may hear your word, come to faith, throw all their evil deeds into the fire and be burned up forever, and be cleansed by your blood and filled with your Spirit. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord Jesus, you have commanded us to pray for our nation, and so in obedience to your word, we pray salvation for our president, the Vice President, the Senate, the House, the Supreme Court, our governors, state legislatures, state, local, and federal officials and judges. Lord, where they're right, sustain them, but where they're wrong, grant the spirit of grace and supplication, that they would recognize their wrong, mourn over their sins for an only Son, throw all their iniquitous decrees into the fire and be burned up forever, and establish policies that are pleasing in your sight and for the furtherance of your kingdom. And Lord, we also pray, especially for our President, the Vice President, and for the House and the Senate. Lord, we know that the theme of the election of President Trump was Make America Great Again. Lord, we agree with that theme, but we also know, Lord, that to make America great again means that as a nation, we need to repent. We need to repent and turn to you. Because, Lord, it's not enough that we change our economics. It's a small thing. We must turn away from the shedding of innocent blood. We must turn away from the rejection of holy marriage. We must turn away from every evil thing that's been embraced in our country. For we live in a society right now, Lord, where evil is considered good and good is considered evil. And there's a great division that comes because, Lord, as a nation, so much of our country has rejected you. And so, Lord, we pray by your Holy Spirit, send the Holy Spirit awakening and revival. Break every heart of stone, and we should receive hearts of flesh to receive your Spirit. open up our eyes and our ears and our hearts to see the wrong that we've done, to get on our knees in true repentance, to turn to the living God and live. And then, Lord, lift your curse from us by the blood of Jesus, so that we may seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness and be truly a great nation. And a great nation is a nation that has the God of Jacob as their God. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord Jesus, we pray for your people Israel. We pray, Lord, that you protect them from the hand of their enemies. We also pray, Lord, that now would be the time when you would fulfill Zechariah 12:10 and they would recognize you, the one who they pierced, mourn over you as for a lonely son. Lord, that they would be cleansed by your blood, filled with your spirit, be the first of nations again, and turn to you and rejoice in you, Lord, as their Messiah, their God, and their Savior, be joined in your church as the one new man. And then come, Lord Jesus, and establish your kingdom. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Lord Jesus, you are the healer, and by your stripes we are healed. And so we pray the healing that you purchased on Calvary's Hill. Here are the lives of Roger Rollis, Robert Jurgensen, Aspen Heisler, Ed Werner, Jadelyn Van Sweden, Bella Rollis, Vicki Seberg, Eloise Jacobson, Emporia Varka, Bryce Johnson, Robert Empty, Jim Jost, Jerry Rosecrans, Jack DeMaine, Joy Sherman, Dave Sullivan, the Knutson family, Tammy Israel, Babe Esterso, Janine Westby, Marilyn Morstick, Doug Holsizer, Elena Schofield, Kate Reagan, Lillian Ernston, Tyler Halverson, Bruce Tiltz, Jake O'Brien, Dana Foster, Louis Hurstman, Audrey Pulse, Helen Beck, Tanya Peterson, Doug Sari, Oliver Sari, Kathy Schaefer, Diane Hiltz, Linda Gallo, Douglas Hurstman, Lois Larson, Ropa Kahara, Monica Parks, David Anderson, Dorothy Johnson, Gianna Kafar, Dr. Herman. Lord, we also pray for our military personnel, Michael Rasmussen, Shane Gettle, Patrick O'Malley, Kayla Dyer, Kevin and Eliza McKenzie, Scott and Barb Riley, Trevor Simmons, Jonathan Defoe, Isaiah Berg, David Berg, and Sammy Neese. And we pray your healing on all those we mention now, either out loud or in our hearts.
I'm going to pray for Ruth Nygaard and for Marcia Rollis on that rotator cuff surgery she's going to have.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
I pray for Jay Strandy that he comes back home safely from Iraq. He's on his 7th tour.
Yes, Lord. Mm-hmm. Yes, Lord. Lord, we pray salvation for Sarah Elbor. Healing for Gene and Kevin McCormick. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
All right, Tom, at this time, I invite you to come up, then you just come right here. You leave that home. All right, let's agree in prayer for Tom. We'll lay hands on him. Gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for the ministry that you've given to Tom and these others as they go to Nicaragua. Lord, we just plead the blood of Jesus on him, and declare what your word says, and he is cleansed and forgiven of all his sins, healed of every wound and every disease, and protected from every attack of the evil one. Lord, we declare that every demonic assignment is canceled, every debt paid in full, every curse is lifted, and he receives the blessings of Abraham and the blessings of the Spirit. Lord, we pray the protection of the blood upon him as he goes and he comes. Lord, surround him with your holy angels and keep him safe. Lord, we also pray open doors for ministry, open doors and open appointments, divine appointments, to share your word with others, for prayer, for deliverance, Lord, for the speaking of the word and for the implanting of the imperishable word of God, which will save many souls. Lord, we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Praise God. Right. And as we are his disciples on earth, let us pray as our Lord Jesus taught us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread,
forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and grant you his peace. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
Go in peace. Serve the crucified and risen Lord.
Thanks be to God.
All right, we'll sing our final hymn. Go Tell It on the Mountain, number 7.
Brightness and best of the stars above.
The first lesson for this Sunday is from the prophet Jeremiah, the first chapter, beginning with the fourth verse. Now the word of the Lord came to me, saying, Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. And before you were born, I consecrated you. I appointed you a prophet to the nations. Then I said, Ah, Lord God, behold, I do not know how to speak, for I am only a youth. But the Lord said to me, Do not say, I am only a youth. For to all to whom I send you, you shall go. And whatever I command you, you shall speak. Do not be afraid of them, for I am with you to deliver you, declares the Lord. Then the Lord put out his hand and touched my mouth. And the Lord said to me, Behold, I have put my words in your mouth. See, I have sent you this day over nations and over kingdoms to pluck up and to break down, to destroy and to overthrow, to build and plant. Here ends the reading of the first lesson.
Psalm today is 114, it's on page 271. Hallelujah, when Israel came out of Egypt,
the house of Jacob from a people of strange speech,
Judah became God's sanctuary,
and Israel his dominion.
The sea beheld it and fled.
Jordan turned and went back.
Mountains skipped like rams.
And the little hills like young sheep.
What ailed you, O sea, that you fled?
O Jordan, that you turned back.
You mountains that you skipped like rams.
You little hills like young sheep.
Tremble, O earth, at the presence of the Lord.
At the presence of the God of Jacob.
Who turned the hard rock into a pool of water.
And flint stone into a flowing spring. Here ends the reading of the psalm. The second lesson is from St. Paul's first letter to Corinthians, the 9th chapter, beginning with the 24th verse. St. Paul writes, by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. Do you not know that in a race all the runners run, but only one receives the prize? So run that you may obtain it. Every athlete exercises self-control in all things. They do it to receive a perishable wreath, but we an imperishable. So I do not run aimlessly. I do not box as a being in the air, but I discipline my body and keep it under control, lest after preaching to others, I myself should be disqualified. Here is the reading of the second lesson. And I invite you to please rise for the reading of the gospel. Kingdom of heaven is like a master of a house who went out early in the morning to hire laborers for his vineyard. After agreeing with the laborers for a denarius a day, he sent them into his vineyard. And going out about the third hour, he saw others standing idle in the marketplace. And to them he said, "You go into the vineyard too, and whatever is right I will give you." So they went. Going out again, at about the sixth hour and the ninth hour, he did the same. And about the 11th hour, he went out and found others standing. And he said to them, "Why do you stand here idle all day?" They said to him, "Because no one has hired us." He said to them, "You go into the vineyard too." And when evening came, the owner of the vineyard said to the foreman, "Call the laborers and pay them their wages, beginning with the last up to the first." And when those hired about the 11th hour came, each one of them received a denarius. Now when those hired first came, they thought they would receive more, but each of them also received a denarius. And on receiving it, they grumbled at the master of the house, saying, "These last worked only 1 hour, and you have made them equal to us, who have borne the burden of the day and the scorching heat." But he replied to one of them, "Friend, I am doing you no wrong. Did you not agree with me for a denarius? Take what belongs to you and go. I choose to give to this last worker as I give to you. Am I not allowed to do what I choose with what belongs to me? Or do you begrudge my generosity?" So the last will be first, and the first last. The Gospel of our Lord. You may be seated. Let us pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you. We thank you that you've gathered us to be in the presence of your Son, for he has promised that where two or three are gathered in his name, there he is in the midst of them. So we welcome you, Lord Jesus, and we give you the glory and the praise and the honor and the worship that belongs to you. Lord, as we come before you this morning, we just ask that you open up our eyes to see and our ears to hear and our hearts to receive. And whatever is of sin, or of temptation, or of the flesh, or of the devil, we pray, Lord, that it would fall to the ground and die and be of no effect, so that we're completely open to receive from you what you have for us today. Let your word be planted deeply in our hearts and bear fruit for eternal life. And now, Lord, may the word of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be truly acceptable in your sight, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Amen. Thank you. Grace to you, peace from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. In the prophet Jeremiah, we read these words in verse 5. He says, "Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. And before you were born, I consecrated you." These words have a great deal of significance for us as Christians, but also from the society in which we live and from the world in which we live. And so I'd like us to explore these words, this word of God, more closely. And in particular, I want us to consider this. Who determines the value of your life? Who determines the sacredness of your life? How does that get resolved? We find here in these words something that we need as people of God, but our society needs to hear as well. Again, God says, "Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. And before you were born, I consecrated you." What that means is that your value and my value, your sacredness and my sacredness, are not determined from the time of our conception, not determined from the time of our birth, not determined from the moment that your parents decide whether they love you or not, not determined by society, not determined by how valuable you are, what you have to give to society. Your value, your sacredness, your purpose were determined by God even before you were conceived. What that means is this. You and I and every human being that has ever existed, they are not, and we are not, accidents. We are not here because of the will of man. We're not here because society says we should be. We exist because God Himself determined even before we were formed in the womb that we should be here for His purposes. By the way, that's good news. It's good news because it means that each and every human being has within him or her intrinsic value. We have value no matter what the world says about us. We have value whether or not your parents want you. We have value whether society says you should exist or not. We have value because God Himself has said, I knew you, I set you apart, I consecrated you, I have a purpose for your life. And no one can take that away. No one has the right to take that away. And it's very important for us to see. Now, there are some people who will say, well, okay, Pastor, if everybody has a purpose in life, then why don't we see people acting according to God's purpose more often? Well, it's a very simple answer. It's called sin. We have sin in our lives. We have a sinful nature. And once we're conceived, we have that sin nature in us, and we're naturally oriented away from what God wants. But God sent His Son, Jesus, into the world to take care of the sin issue in our lives. And when we come to Him in faith, in repentance, confessing our sins, God the Father will forgive our sins, cleanse us by the blood of Jesus, fill us with the Holy Spirit, and establish us in the purpose that He created for us well before we were ever a twinkle in our parents' eyes. Well before you were ever considered, God had established a plan for you and good works for you to perform. The problem with the human race isn't that God hasn't given us a purpose. The problem with the human race is that sin has kept us from going forward into those purposes. But God, through Jesus, sent His Son to establish us again into the purposes that the Father has for us. Every human being, then, originally has a godly purpose and function to fulfill. And that's why, as Christians, it's very important for us to connect people up with Jesus. Because every human being, no matter how small, no matter how large, no matter how old, has this divine appointment and purpose on their life. But they will never know about it unless we preach the word, share Jesus, and they meet the Lord, and then are filled with His Spirit, so that they can walk by His grace and the purposes that He had for them from the very beginning. But now, I want to address something else that's very, very important. And by the way, when this word was given to me, I was not thinking about the significance of this day. I really wasn't. I did not know that today is Sanctity of Life Sunday. And I did not know that this is the day when Roe versus Wade was enacted. But today, when we hear this word, what is God saying to our country and to the Christians of this country? He is saying something very important. And this isn't about politics, folks. It's about what God's word says. Every human being, every human being, has a God-given purpose and is made in the image of the Almighty. And according to God, you and I do not have the right to kill off those who are made in the image of God. We do not have the right to cut off the life of those who are in the womb. We do not have the right to say to the old and the infirm and those who have emotional and mental problems, well, you're not offering anything to society, so I guess you have to die. And please understand that Planned Parenthood was established by a woman and by those who supported her who had every intention of killing off black people and poor whites and Hispanics because they believed they were inferior people who had nothing to offer society and they were not worthy of the breath of life. That's a sin. It's a sin. Because you don't get to decide whether someone is worthy of the breath of life. God does. And when God says, before I knew you, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you, that means that God, as soon as someone's conceived, guess what? God had already planned before the earth was even formed, that person is here for a purpose. And who are we to try to stop God's purpose? Somebody might say, well, you know, that person may not have been a productive member of society. Big deal. God had a purpose. Even if that child only lives 2 minutes, God had a purpose for that child. You have a purpose and a plan that you don't get to decide. God's already decided it. And please understand that God can use your life, especially when you're not in control anymore. I'll give you one example. It actually has to do with an older woman. It was like my first couple of years of ministry, and I was going down to Devil's Lake, and I was at the nursing home. It was called the Lutheran Home at that time. And there was a lady there in a coma, and she had never spoken to her family, certainly not to me, in the couple of years that I had seen her, and considered her in a vegetative state. So her husband and her son, adult son, asked him to come and give communion to the group. So I went down. And she can't take communion, obviously. But we're getting things ready, and we get to the Lord's Prayer. And we conclude, with thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. And the husband said amen. And the son said amen. And to the amazement of everybody in the room, she said amen. That wasn't by her strength. That was God saying something. Remember what Jesus said to those who believe, I will not leave you orphaned. She had lost everything, but not him. Not him. It was a witness to those in the room. And by the way, if that was the only reason that she was born, she fulfilled her destiny by imparting faith into her family. And even faith to me. We don't have a right to determine for others whether their purpose meets our agenda and therefore they're allowed to live. We don't have that right. That life in the womb, all the way to the natural ending of life, is God's life, filled with His purpose. Designed to share the love of God and the truth of His Word with others. As the church, we must never agree with society that says that it is a person's right. In fact, their duty to kill those who are in the womb. And we must never agree with a state that says, well, if you don't feel like your life has any purpose, you are free to kill yourself. Or you're free to have a doctor do it for you. As a church, our job is to declare the Word of God and invite people to meet Jesus so that they can walk in the purpose that God has for them. So on this Sanctity of Life Sunday, as we consider all the marches that were going on yesterday, let's pray that the Lord will put an end to abortion and put an end to euthanasia and put an end to the lie of the enemy that says to people that your worth and your value is determined by what you say or I say or the world says or what you can accomplish. If you're here, you have a divine mandate and purpose to exist. Our job as a church is to help people meet Jesus so they can fulfill that destiny.